Shabbat shalom again, everyone.
Shabbat shalom.
This is the second broadcast. We decided to do two today on the Sabbath. First one was kind of short, and we just kind of wanted to, there was a couple of things we wanted to talk about, and this is very interesting. It's very interesting. We want to first of all thank everyone for giving us such nice messages concerning our anniversary.
All the beautiful well wishes, we thank you.
Yeah, we thank you for that. It was just so wonderful, you know. on our anniversary, we decided to go to the show, and we saw a particular movie by the name of War Room. Very interesting movie.
Yes, indeed.
Very interesting.
Yes, indeed. Of course, you have to get past a lot of the Christian stuff, you know, but if you can just put on your spiritual ears and look past all of that stuff and look at the message, the overall message of the War Room is very, very powerful for this day and time, but you have to put on your spiritual ears.
Yeah, you got to get past all the Christian junk, because you know, whenever they do a Christian movie, it's going to be packed with all this stuff. So if you can just simply view the movie like it's a piece of fish that someone caught out of the lake and they didn't fillet it, okay?
Right, you got to pick the bones out yourself.
You got to get all those bones out yourself and just look past a lot of that stuff and try to get the message that's in the movie. Mm-hmm. Because the overall message that's in the movie is very powerful. Mm-hmm. Now, we're not going to tell you what the movie was. We're going to just tell you what it's about, but we ain't going to get into the details in case you want.
Of the specific movie.
Yeah, exactly.
We just want to talk about how the movie impacted us and how it can impact all of us.
That's right. Now, for years, I've already, you know, what's amazing was I was already doing this thing for years. The movie is basically about an old woman who has a room that she called the War Room. Mm-hmm. And it's basically a prayer room.
Yes.
Okay. But the concept that it was going to battle, praying is like going to battle, mm-hmm. was incredible.
Yes.
Very incredible. Mm-hmm. And what's amazing was this was something that I was already doing. So when I saw all the things that the woman was doing in the movie, I was like, wow, the Most High gave me this. I'm doing this stuff more than 10 years ago. I was doing these things.
And 10 years ago? 15 years ago.
That's right. Yeah, it's about 15 years ago. That's right. Yeah. that I was doing this, and I didn't really have a particular closet like she had, but I was going in our family room. I would go down in our family room early in the morning, and I would have these prayers. I had this list of prayers that I was always just going before the Most High, like I was wrestling with Him to have Him answer these prayers. Mm-hmm. And I'm not telling you, I still got the list of prayers. Everything I prayed about literally came to pass. I mean, He literally gave and did for me everything that I prayed about. Mm-hmm. And I was sitting there, I could go down and listen, like, done, 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 just all of these things, because I was going before the Most High just in just travailing before Him in prayer. Now, that's what this movie is about. Mm-hmm. Very deep. Mm-hmm.
And the movie also talks about, how when there are things that you are up against, that you can't look at those things and whine and cry about them.
Yeah.
You got to go to your war room.
Yeah.
I love that terminology, the terminology war room, because this is a battle. It's a spiritual battle. Yeah. And this goes back to the scripture that says, put on the whole armor of Yah.
That's right.
That ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. The wiles of the devil are the devices.
That's right.
And see those things. And then it says, we wrestle not against flesh and blood. We have to understand what our wrestle and our battle is who it is with. Even though people are used in these things, the wrestle and the fight is really not with the people. Most of these people have been infiltrated by something or occupied by something.
That's right.
That's causing them to do the things that they're doing. And so when you go before the Most High in prayer, you have to look at this as a battle plan.
That's right.
You see, and one point that I do want to make about the movie, that it, in the very beginning, they were like at a war table or whatever, and they were talking about a strategy.
That's right.
That's why we titled this The War Room Strategy, how you have to be one step ahead of the enemy. You have to know the enemy's thoughts. And so, and going back to our previous broadcast that we just did, when I think about how we fight amongst each other,
yeah,
the enemy is looking at us. They're looking because it's so open. Our fight is so open against each other that the enemy is at his war room table devising a strategy based on all of that.
That's right.
You see, they know just how to get us. They put us against each other. That's their strategy. And so when I saw this war room strategy in the beginning, how they were saying you have to plot out and know what the enemy is doing at all times.
That's right.
And that includes keeping your strategy hidden.
That's right.
If you are exposing your whole game plan to the enemy, you are not a wise fighter at all.
That's right.
You cannot expose your strategy. You cannot show divisions and contentions amongst your team because you're going to lose.
That's right.
So this whole war room strategy, and anyone who wants to drop any scriptures or say anything about this, that would be great. This is going to be more like a discussion for us because that movie had a very powerful message. Again, getting past the Christian stuff, it had a very powerful message that if you are up against something, your strategy should be to go in that war room and you lay it out. You post scriptures on your wall, wherever you can post them, you post those scriptures and you put those before the Most High. And guess what, y'all? There got to be some weeping and moaning with this too.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of times when we pray, if you find your prayer just being very basic all the time, where you just say it almost as if you're trying to just get it out the way type thing, you might as well keep it.
Yeah, you might as well keep it.
The Most High don't need it. We are the ones who need this.
That's right.
He don't need it, you see. So when we go before the Most High in prayer, sometimes you got to shed some tears. Sometimes your face got to get ugly when you go before the Most High in prayer because this is your heart crying out. This is you saying, look, Father, I need something. When I say I need something, don't go before the Most High crying about no house or no car, you see.
Mm-hmm.
I'm talking about we need something for our spirit man. Now, if you're homeless, that's different. You can cry before the Most High for a place to stay. I'm not saying that. I'm talking about people who want to cry before the Most High because they want a bigger mansion or a bigger house or a better, finer car. The Most High got
spoiled brat.
Right. Yeah, that's a spoiled brat cry. Thank you. When I say cry before the Most High, there are things that we as a people need.
There was
a passage I read where it said that the daughters of Zion, the daughters of Judah, have to teach their own daughters.
That's right.
In our captivities.
That's right.
How to weep and moan and wail before the Most High.
You hear that? Weep, moan, and wail.
You see? Because our children need to understand the position that we're in.
That's
we're
right.
in a bad place right now as it relates to where we should be. You see, we are in a bad place. And
we're
once
the land
our
of
children,
our captivity.
Yes, we're in the land of our captivity. And our children need to know that and understand that. And so to my sisters out here who have daughters, the Most High has mandated us to teach our daughters how to weep and wail and moan before him.
That's right.
For all of us, we have to learn this. It's something that we have to do.
Yeah. And you want to know something? And there's a scripture I want to talk to you about. And I have a video that I put online some time ago, last year sometime. The name of the video is called Why I Pray. You need to look at that video, okay?
Mm-hmm.
One thing that I learned years ago is the Most High showed me, gave me revelation about prayer. And there were times when I prayed to the Most High where I got quick. The fastest answers was usually when I went to the Most High, and it's weird. I may have been upset about something, and I was literally just wrestling, trying to get this prayer through to the Most High. Okay. Even recently, there were things that I was dealing with, and I've learned that I get faster answers from the Most High when I go to him like this. Now, one thing that's amazing is sometimes we don't understand because we see that passage in Matthew. When it says, when ye pray, pray like this, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. We see that that's really a format. He's telling you these are some of the things you need to pray. You know, like what says, thy will be done. You need to pray about his will when you pray. Mm-hmm. So he's just telling you some of the things, forgiving for all my trespasses. So he's telling you things that you need. It's a format.
Mm-hmm. Not a script.
Not a script, exactly. Mm-hmm. So basically what's amazing here is that I learned over the years, okay, that it's very important that you learn how to press through with praying. Is that you gotta have, you gotta get kind of emotional when you pray about the things that you know. Because to me, it's not really a serious prayer. Let's say you praying for somebody that in your family that's close to you are sick. And you go to the Most High and pray, and you go there and you say, oh, Father, you know, my brother is sick. I just want you to, you know, bless him, heal him, you know. I mean, think about that prayer. You know, if it was my brother, I'd be, oh, Father, bless my brother, Father. I need you to heal him, Father. I need you to go there, Father. I mean, I'm pressing through. I'm wrestling. Now, guess what? I'm sort of like this, and I've learned this because of Elijah. When he prayed for rain, he got, look, he asked his servant, he said, you see anything? He said, nope, I don't see nothing. So what did he do? Get back down and start praying again, right? That's really how we're supposed to pray. We supposed to pray without ceasing, which means we supposed to just be very consistent, yes. You know, very just persistent when we pray, you know? And so it's kind of like a wrestling thing that we do, you know, it's a wrestle that you do. And see, you're supposed to pray for that thing until you see it coming. If you don't see it coming, then you better keep praying about the thing. Yeah. Don't just give up after the ninth or tenth time and say, well, you know what? Yeah, obviously I ain't gonna do it. You know, I'm tired of bending my knees and hurting my knees on this particular subject. No, you keep praying.
Yeah, the scripture says the effectual, fervent prayer of the righteous availeth much.
That's right.
I want to go to the scripture that, let me see what the sister's name is. We've read this before, but Sister Alicia posted Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10 through 20, and I just want to read that. Right. That's a good passage for this, okay? It says, finally, my brethren, be strong in Yahuwah and in the power of His might.
War.
Put on the whole armor of Yah that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Therefore, take unto you the whole armor of Yah that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day. And having done all to stand, stand. Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the Bessorah of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye will be able to quench the fiery darts of the wicked. And take the helmet of Yahusha, and the sword of the Ruach, which is the word of Yahuwah, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Ruach, and watching therefore thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all Kodeshim, and for me the utterance may be given unto me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the Bessorah, for which I am an ambassador in bonds, that therein I may speak boldly as I ought to speak.
Mm. Interesting. Now, that whole armor passage there, you know, it sounds like he's talking about being preparing for war.
Yes.
Preparing for war.
Yes.
Notice he mentions prayer in that passage too.
Yes.
You see?
Yes.
I'm telling you, when I watched the movie and I saw them put it in the perspective that they did in the movie, I was like, wow, it was awesome. You know, I really did like it. You know, what they were saying as far as this is a war room. You're going in there because it's time to fight.
Yes.
You know, and meditation also, it's like a form of fighting.
Yes.
You know, meditation, you speak in the word of Yah, you speaking against your adversary. It's a form of fighting.
Yes.
You understand? And one particular scene I like in the movie was when the lady went outside. Mm-hmm. Remember when she finally got angry? See, she had to get angry. At first, she was going in the room just praying, and it wasn't working. You know, the ball when some things started happening, and she got angry. See, sometimes you got to get angry at the enemy, at the wicked enemy, at what he's doing.
Yes.
You get what I'm saying? eventually you got to get angry. You got to get tired of what he's doing. And then it's time to fight. Now, I got a very interesting story. The Most High showed me this a long time ago. When I saw a thing a long time ago, I knew that it was important that I have a solid prayer life. Okay. This story is coming from Genesis chapter 32. So turn to Genesis chapter 32, and we're going to start reading at 24, but I'm going to bring you up to par to what was going on here, okay? At the time, you know the story of Esau and Jacob, right? Jacob put on the skin of an animal so that he can deceive his father into getting a blessing, and then he had to flee. All those years flee because he knew Esau was upset. Esau was like, I'm going to kill him. Jacob knew it too, right? So this is finally after so long of a time it went by, and Jacob's now coming back around to where Esau is. And so Jacob was a little nervous. He was a little afraid. He was like, oh, man, Esau going to kill me. I don't know what to do, you know? So anyway, let you make a long story short, this is where we're at here at this point. So now, let's start here at verse 24. Deborah, I'm going to have you start. Read 24 through
the 22nd chapter.
Read a little. Yeah, I guess you can read to
32,
verse 24 through 28.
And Yaakov was left alone.
Yaakov is Jacob, for those of you that don't know.
And there wrestled a man with him until the breaking of the day. And when he saw that he prevailed not against him, he touched the hollow of his thigh, and the hollow of Yaakov's thigh was out of joint as he wrestled with him. And he said, let me go, for the day breaks. And he said, I will not let you go except you bless me. And he said unto him, what is your name? And he said, Yaakov. And he said, your name shall be called no more Yaakov, but Israel. For as a prince have you power with Elohim and with men, and have prevailed.
And have prevailed. Okay, now, I tell you why this is so important. Because what's amazing was, back in the days when I was a Christian, when I first saw this, okay, there was a movie that I saw where they actually showed this scene. When I saw him wrestling with the person, that's when I began to realize what was going on. Now, what's amazing about this passage here is many commentaries, they get this mixed up. They don't know if it was an angel he was wrestling with, or was actually Yah himself in the form of man that he wrestled with, okay? Because the scripture says that he wrestled with, verse 28, he said, what is thy name? He said, no, thy name shall no more be called Jacob, but Israel. For as a prince, thou hast power with Yah and with men. So people would interpret that and say, man, maybe he wrestled with Yah or whatever. Okay. And a lot of them will say that he wrestled with Yah, or he could have wrestled with an angel. I could say that it could be both, because usually when the Most High sent an angel, it's like Yah going forth to do it. Mm-hmm. You understand?
Yes.
Because that's how the scripture talks in that sense, that it was Yah doing it. Okay. But anyway, Yaakov. Okay. Imagine this. It's dark. It's heading toward the morning. Think about how spiritual this is. And there met him this man that wrestled with him until the breaking of the day. So Jacob was literally wrestling physically with this man, like we do spiritually with Yah in prayer. He was wrestling with his hand.
Yes.
Now, one thing I learned about Yah is there's something about the early morning, something very spiritual about the early morning, that he prefers that you come to him in the early morning. Okay. Mm-hmm. And as a matter of fact, it's kind of amazing. I find myself waking up so much at between 3 and 5 o'clock. And happen to pray between 3 and 5 always. I always wake up almost every night like that, you know. But I've learned that there's something about that early morning. Now, I'll tell you why. If you remember the story in the scriptures when it talked about the manna coming down, did you know that Israel had to gather the manna before the sun came up?
Wow.
because the sun would cause the manna to melt. Mm-hmm. So they had to gather all that they were going to eat before the sun. Now, that's amazing. Think about that. Eat. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
To eat.
Mm-hmm.
You see that? That's spiritual.
Mm-hmm.
So he's saying you got to gather. Now, there's a reason for it, because once the day gets going and all the intervening activities are going to rob you of what you were supposed to fill your belly with.
Mm-hmm.
You get it? So the Most High requires that. He wants you to get up early and get in his word and pray early. Now notice what the person said to him. He said that he wrestled with until the breaking of the day, right? So when he saw that he prevailed not against him, he touched the hollow of Jacob's thigh. And the hollow of Jacob's thigh was out of joint, and he wrestled with this particular man, okay? And he said to him, now he said to Jacob, he said, told Jacob, let me go. But Jacob said what? He said, let me go. Why? Because the daybreaker.
Mm-hmm.
He said, let me go, the daybreaker. And Jacob said, I will not let you go except thou bless me. Mm-hmm. You see the type of mentality we supposed to have when we wrestle with Yah in prayer? This is the type of mindset we supposed to have. We supposed to say, no, I will not let you go until you bless me. I will not. Now that's when the Most High changed his name and blessed him.
Wow.
You see that? Changed his name and blessed him.
Mm-hmm.
So we got to learn how to wrestle in prayer with the Most High. We got to learn how to wrestle.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we can't let adversity come up on us, come crashing down, and that's when we pray.
Yeah.
You see, that's what most of us do. We wait until all hell breaks loose, and then we start praying and weeping and moaning. We need to do that ahead of time.
That's right.
We look at another person, or we look at our own life, should I say, and we say, well, everything's going fine in my life. All is well. The day is happy. The day is bright. You see? And so we don't feel the need to pray like that.
That's right.
But that's where that I am my brother's keeper thing comes in.
Yeah.
When you look over yonder, and I thank the Most High that ever since I was a child, I can remember having a burden of compassion for my people, even as a child.
Mm-hmm.
That's what we need. We need to look at our brother or our sister, and when we see them ailing, when we see them sad and hurt, we should feel that.
That's right.
We shouldn't look at them and say, that's their situation, that's their pain, that's their hurt.
You should be praying for them.
We should be praying for them.
Right.
We should be touched by that. You know, how the scripture says that the Most High draws nigh to those that are of a broken heart and a contrite spirit. We should have that same feeling. If we see our brother or sister crying about something, that should touch us. You see, we should be bothered by their tears or their sadness, you know? And so I wanted to read this passage that Nia, daughter of Zion, posted. Is a very good passage here. I thank you all for all the scriptures you're posting, but this one is very good. It's in Psalms 17. And I think I'm going to read all of it. This is a short chapter, verse 1 through 15. But we're talking about prayer and the war room strategy here. And so many, many times we don't know how to pray. And so therefore, the scripture says when you pray amiss, not knowing how to pray.
That's right.
You see, we have to know how to pray and understand what prayer is and what it does. Like I said before, this is not doing a favor for the Most High.
So ain't.
This is for us. He don't need it. We do. And so we need to learn how to pray. And if we don't know, say, Father, teach me how. But one thing we have to understand in our prayer, that we have to be sincere. And we have to understand what it is we're doing. So I'm going to go ahead and start reading this. It says, hear the right, O Yahuwah. Attend unto my cry. Give ear unto my prayer that goes not out of feigned lips. Let my sentence come forth from your presence. Let your eyes behold the things that are equal. You have proved my heart. You have visited me in the night. You have tried me and shall find nothing. I am purposed that my mouth shall not transgress. Concerning the works of men, by the word of your lips, I have kept me from the path of the destroyer. Hold up my goings in your cycles, that my footsteps slip not. I have called upon you, for you will hear me, O El. Incline your ear unto me and hear my speech. Show your marvelous loving kindness, O you that save by your right hand them which put their trust in you from those that rise up against them. Keep me as the apple of the eye. Hide me under the shadow of your wings. Hallelujah. From the wicked that oppress me, from my deadly enemies who compass me about. They are enclosed in their own fat. With their mouth they speak proudly. They have now compassed us in our steps. They have set their eyes bowing down to the earth, like as the lion that is greedy of his prey, and as it were a young lion lurking in secret places. Arise, O Yahuwah, disappoint him, cast him down, deliver my soul from the wicked, which is your sword, hallelujah, from men which are your hand, O Yahuwah, from men of the world, which have their portion in this life, and whose bellies you fill with your hid treasures. They are full of children and leave the rest of their substance to their babies. As for me, I will behold your face in righteousness. I shall be satisfied when I awake with your likeness. Hallelujah. That was a very, very powerful passage for the children of Israel. Mm-hmm. That the Most High, he will protect us from our enemies.
That's right.
But we have to cry out to him. She started off the verse. Yeah. I mean, he started off the verse saying, hear my cry. Attend unto my cry. Give ear to my prayer.
Yeah, you got to cry out to the Most High. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you got to cry out to him. You know, it's amazing, you know, that we, it's so much to understand about this, you know, and so much that's misunderstood about praying, you know. We are so cautious when we pray because we know we're going before the Most High. And sometimes we can get a little afraid of how we pray to him because, yeah, I'm going before Yah, whatever, you know. But I've learned over the years the Most High wants you to be bold.
Yes.
Now, I'm going to share this scripture with you real quickly here. This scripture here, when I first read this, it's when it took me on I had me shocked completely, mm-hmm. you know. But this scripture is in Isaiah chapter 45. I want you to look at what it says here. This is really amazing scripture. Verse 11. Chapter 45, verse 11. It says, thus saith Yahuwah, the Holy One of Israel, his maker. Ask me of things to come concerning my sons and concerning the work of my hands. Command ye me.
Mm, yes.
You know, when I first came across that scripture, I thought I was seeing things. He said, concerning the works of my hands, concerning things to come, mm-hmm. concerning my sons. So he's talking about the future. Concerning the things to come, concerning my sons and the work of my hands, he said, what? Command ye me. Mm-hmm. Command Yah?
Yes.
Wait a minute. What do you mean by command Yah? Well, I'll tell you what we mean by it, what he means by it in the scriptures, right? Now, what does he say in the word, right? We're gonna tackle this from the word. The word says what? Ask and it shall be given, right? Seek and ye shall find, knock and it shall be opened unto you, right? Mm-hmm. Now, the scripture, there's also other passages where it talks about prayer where Yahushua made mention. He said that if ye abide in me and my words abide in you, ask what ye will, right? Mm-hmm. Now, there are a lot of times I notice I'll be walking in his ways, right? And his word will be abiding in me and I'll be asking for something and that thing wouldn't be happening, right? I want you to hear what I'm saying to you here. Okay. I remember a couple of times, right? Mm-hmm. That I was praying to the Most High about some things. One time I was going through some financial problems. This is when we were living in Westland. Mm-hmm. We were going through some financial problems. Living in an apartment, we had bills galore, and we were just trying. I was trying to work jobs, trying to do whatever, just going through this financial problem. So I'm praying, I'm looking at the word, I'm like, I'm keeping your word, I'm doing this, I'm doing all this here. And I'm like, man, you said your word, if I abide in you and your words abide in me, you know, so I'm getting a little, you see the tone?
Yes.
I'm getting a little upset. I'm like, well, Father, you said in your word, I didn't say it. And I was like, Father, I wouldn't have believed it if you hadn't have read it in your word, right? Mm-hmm. So now a lot of you probably say, oh, my kids, you better calm down, pray back, calm down. No, I didn't. I went to the Most High. I said, Father, you said in your word that your host will suffer poverty, that I, through his poverty, might be rich, right? And I said, well, Father, right now, I don't have a dime in my pocket. I need some help financially, you know? So I just really just started praying to the Most High, just praying like this, right? Mm-hmm. And then the Most High spoke to me in the midst of that prayer that may seem angry to you all, right? He spoke to me and said, what does my word say concerning this?
Mm-hmm.
Just like that, right? Mm-hmm. And it caught me off. I said, whoa, hurry, too. And I said, okay, well, let me go and see what his word say. So I started digging in the word about what his word say about poverty and prosperity, right? Mm-hmm. I came across scripture that says, I know that
thy word
tribulation and poverty, but thou art rich. I said, why does it, but thou art rich? He said, I know that you're poor, you ain't got a dime in your pocket, but you're really rich. So I said, whoa, wait a minute. I said, are you trying to tell me that I'm really prosperous, but I just don't know it? Ah, see, there it go. Mm-hmm. See, that's what the problem is. That's why we must meditate. You see, one of the things I need to add to this thing is the scripture says the wealth of the wicked is stored up for the righteous.
Mm-hmm.
You see, those are some things we need to meditate on because he says, but we're rich. So you need to meditate as it relates to prosperity by saying, I am prosperous.
Mm-hmm.
I am wealthy. I am rich in Yah.
Yeah.
Right? See, when you make those confessions, I called my wife in the living room that day. You remember that day?
Yes.
I called her in the living room. I said, baby. I said, we got it all wrong. I said, we've been believing a lie. I said, because we judge reality by the response of our senses. So we look at our wallets, we don't see any money. We look at our bills, we don't have any money. We look at all of these struggles and we judge our reality based on that. Nope, you should judge your reality based on what the scriptures say. Are you getting what I'm saying here? So when the scripture says you're rich, that's what you need to meditate on, that you're rich. So then basically I had got to a point, I said, wow. So I begin to start commanding of Yah what his words say.
Mm-hmm.
You see, holding him to his own word.
Yes.
Because I didn't say it. He said it. Who said that you are more than a conqueror? Did you say it or did it originate from him? Huh? Who said that greater is he that is in you? Huh?
Yes.
Did you say it first or did it originate from him?
Mm-hmm.
You get what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So this is why prayer is so important. We got to hold him to his word.
Yes.
We got to tell him, Father, yeah, you the one that said this. You said that you were going to do this.
Mm-hmm.
Now you got to stand on your word, Father, yeah,
mm-hmm.
because your word can't return void. It cannot return void. This is how you got to pray to him.
That's right.
You see, you got to tell him your word cannot return void. It had already left your mouth, Father.
Yes.
So it must accomplish where you sent it.
That's right.
You know what that does? It creates a force in your life.
That's right. Hallelujah.
You hear what I'm saying? It forces the things of Yah to come into your life because now you done held him to his word.
Mm-hmm. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Father. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Well, I want to come back with another very powerful piece from Brother Gideon. Jeremiah, the 15th chapter, 15 through 21. And reading through this, I mean, these are some very powerful scriptures. And I thank the Most High because we all need to learn this war room strategy today.
Yes.
We need to learn this and stop with the little weak prayers where we ain't even touching our ceiling.
Yeah.
We gotta get through to our Father.
That's
we have
right.
to pretend like we crying out from the grave, y'all. Like they done buried us and we ain't dead.
That's right.
You know what I'm saying? We have to pretend like we 6 feet under trying to fight our way out.
That's right. Hallelujah.
You know, if you're down there, you fighting for your life and you trying to get out and you only got a few moments of breath left. You know what I'm saying? You're gonna be screaming, especially if you hear people up top. You ain't gonna be saying help. help me because somebody helped me down here.
Exactly.
You're going to be crying out because you need help.
That's right. See?
That's what we have to do. When we go before the Most High, we got to get this, y'all. We got to get an understanding on how we have to go to the Father.
That's right. Boldly.
I'm not saying every single time you pray, you go like that. But there are some times where it's just not enough to just sit there and talk. I mean, it's wonderful to talk to the Most High.
Yeah.
I do that a lot. But there are days I've heard my husband crying to the Father.
Yeah.
He's heard me crying to the Father. Some days you just can't help it. That's the only thing that's going to help. You got to cry to him. I mean, like, boo-hoo cry until your eyes are swollen. Mm-hmm. And that's the only time you feel like you're getting through.
Yeah.
And certain things bring that about. Sometimes troubles bring that about. Sometimes sickness brings that about. But what about when your brother or sister is suffering?
Mm-hmm.
What about our people? That should bring it about, too. And that's what the Most High is trying to get us to do. He said, that's whosoever right. shall call on the name of Yahuwah shall be saved.
That's right.
During our time of affliction, we need to call upon the Father. We need to weep and wail.
That's right.
Okay, I'm going to go to Jeremiah 15, verse 15 through 21. Oh, Yah, thou knowest. Remember me and visit me and revenge me of my persecutors. Take me not away in thy long suffering.
Wow.
Know that for thy sake I have suffered rebuke. Thy words were found, and I did eat them. And thy word was unto me the joy and rejoicing of my heart. For I am called by thy name, O Yah, Elohim of hosts. I sat not in the assembly of the mockers, nor rejoiced. I sat alone because of thy hand. For thou hast filled me with indignation. Why is my pain perpetual and my wound incurable, which refuses to be healed? Wilt thou be altogether unto me as a liar and as a water that fail?
Ooh.
You hear what this person is asking the Most High? Mm-hmm. You hear what he's asking them?
Wow. What's that passage again? Let me write this
Jeremiah
down.
15, verse 15 through 21.
Wow.
Then he said, "That therefore, thus saith Yah, if thou return, then will I bring thee again, and thou shalt stand before me. And if thou take forth the precious from the vial, thou shalt be as my mouth. Let them return unto thee. Be returned not thou unto them, but return not unto them. And I will make thee unto this people a fence, brazen wall, and they shall fight against thee, but they shall not prevail against thee. For I am with thee to save thee and to deliver thee, saith Yah. And I will deliver thee out of the hand of the wicked, and I will redeem thee out of the hand of the terrible."
Mm. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. These are some very good passages to read because we have to know that sometimes when we go before the Most High, we have to hold him to his word.
Yeah,
literally, that's what it's saying. Said, Father, this is what you have promised.
Yeah.
And I am taking heed to this. Now I need you to make good on what you promised me.
That's right.
You see, I need you to make good on that because, Father, I'm doing what you asked me to do. I don't know what else to do.
You know, it's amazing. You know, this is, I'm telling you, I'm so thankful that we decided to do another one. You know, sometimes we come up against hindrances, right, in our life when we're trying to do things. Now, sometimes the Most High will give you something to do, okay? He may have a job for you to do or something particular that you're doing for him even. And you come and you find all these hindrances and all this stuff. Well, let me tell you about an incident that happened to me. You know, I've had a number of these incidents that happened, but I know that what the Most High has given us to do, okay, and it deals with video, okay, video editing and production of documentaries and different things that he had put on our spirit to do, okay? Now, let me tell you what happened one time, right? My computer had started getting real sluggish with these viruses, and I don't have an ordinary computer. I have a lot of RAM on my computer. So for it to start to go through all these problems, and plus I know how to clean computers, I do all of that stuff. You know, I know how to do all that, right? So I'm doing everything, getting out viruses, it's all kinds of stuff, right? That somehow got on my computer because of something I had downloaded. And eventually I said, okay, there's only one way to really deal with this. I'm going to just redo my computer completely back to factory settings. So I had all my files, external drives anyway, right? So we know because of what I do for the Most High in the computer production, in the video production area, that it's very crucial that my stuff is working right. Tell you what happened. When I redid the computer, the factory settings, the drives, the letter drives of my external drive changed, right? And the drive, the letter, particular letter that I need to access my programs wasn't showing up anymore. So you know what that means, basically? Mm-hmm. It means that any program or any video that I've ever started and was working on now will not be able to find those video clips or anything that I was doing. Mm-hmm. I have to go in and manually connect them all back to the source, mm-hmm. which could take days, okay? Mm-hmm. Now, to make a long story short, I go on the internet and I'm researching, trying to figure out how to get this light. So I figured out how to change the drive letter, but the particular drive letter wasn't showing up. Mm-hmm. So I'm like, why isn't the drive letter showing up? And no tutorial was there that would help me. So I went through this one page of tutorials and went through the whole page all the way down the list and couldn't find anything in this whole page to help me, right? So I'm really getting worked up because I'm hours into this now, right? Mm-hmm. Finally, I started just getting so frustrated. I said, Father, I need some help here. I need you to help me with this. I said, because you know what you've given me to do. And if I can't do it, I said, so then what? Am I supposed to not do it? You know, I said, do you not want me to do this? You know, and I really got upset. I said, Father, I need your help. I said, because it took me, I'm telling you, it was almost an all-day issue, you know. So anyway, make a long story short, I got so frustrated. I sat back in that chair, and I'm telling you, I had sent the kids out the room. Because there are times when you just get like this, y'all out of the room, because right now I don't need to hear no kids, I don't need to hear nothing. I need to hear the Most High on this because I don't know what to do. And it was all I'll say, Father, I said this to the Father, I said, do you really want me to spend weeks trying to reconnect all this stuff back to the source? Or you know? So I'm getting a little sarcastic, right? And then finally, after my anger, my just frustration and peak, I sat there and it just came to me. Go back to the page that you were at on the internet. So I was like, you know, I started just exiting down all of the different tabs I had up that was dealing with this issue. So I'm just exiting, ain't nothing in this way, ain't nothing in this way, ain't nothing in this. When I got to the last one, to cross out, the Most High spoke to me and said, no, wait, just like that, no, wait. So I'm about to exit it out, you know? It said, no, wait. And so I said, you know, I said, wait, for what? You know, so I went to it and I'm looking at it. And then it was like, scroll down. So I'm scrolling down all the way to the end. And at the very end of this page, someone had a fix. And they say, hey, this is what you need to do if the drive letter isn't showing up. Mm-hmm. It's because of this. So I was like, really? Let me see if this thing works. So I went in there, did it, and it worked. And I sat there, I said, wow. Mm-hmm. Now, Most I heard my prayer. Because he knew, and he didn't want me to spend all that time, right?
Yeah.
Weeks trying to reconnect all that stuff back together, right? But he said, but you know what? I want you to realize that I want you to press through when you need to pray, when you need something from me. Now, I don't want to say disrespect, y'all. Mm-hmm. That's not disrespecting y'all. If you telling them that if you hold them to his word, you know what I'm saying? That's not being disrespectful mm-hmm. to y'all. Because he said it, command ye me, didn't he say it?
Yes.
In his word. So in the whole thing, it was really amazing that when I got the fix and it worked, mm-hmm. I said, wow. I sat there mm-hmm. and I said, Father, you wanted me to go that route, didn't you? Mm-hmm. Now he could have let me see it the first time I was going through there, right?
That's right.
But he didn't, because he wanted to show me something. He wanted to reiterate within my mind how he wants us to be as a people, mm-hmm. how he wants us to press through no matter what. Mm-hmm. You see? And that's what this prayer, I'm telling you, it's like war.
Yes.
It is truly like war, because you could, it was like a battle in that room. I had sent everybody out the room because I was in there. I was in there battling. I ain't gonna nobody get hit with the sword, you know. Because I was getting upset up in that room, you know, mm-hmm. not in a bad way, you know what I'm saying? But mm-hmm. I was really getting upset at the way things were going down, and I wanted to see change. I know I needed this to happen, mm-hmm. and I was already all day with it. Mm-hmm. So I didn't need another day to go by that I was still dealing with that issue.
Yes, absolutely.
You know, hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Well, we got a lot of scriptures posted in the chat. We won't be able to get to all of them. But I think I will copy a lot of these so that we can revisit them. Sheila Bryant posted Psalms 35, and I'm going to read the first verse of that. There was no verse noted, but it's just Psalms 35. But the first verse says, plead my cause, O Yah, with them that strive against me. Then it says, fight against them that fight against me. Now, when you think about that, we're asking the Most High to fight for us. That's a part of our prayer. We need the Most High to fight for us.
Yeah.
We need him to be our strong tower.
That's,
you know,
right.
How the scripture says the name of Yah is a strong tower.
Strong tower, yeah.
The righteous runneth therein and are safe.
That's right.
So in this war, too, we have to remember who is on our side.
That's
we
right.
have the Most High on our side. But another thing we have to remember is the sins that separated us from him. Okay, if we don't want to see his backside, Brother Obadiah posted a scripture that says, if my people, which are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray.
Yeah.
You know, I love that scripture because he's putting it on us too. Mm-hmm. He says, humble yourselves and pray.
That's right.
And seek my face.
That's
How
right.
do you seek a person's face? I'm going to tell you right now, it's hard to convince somebody that you love them when you hardly ever talk to them.
Yeah.
Okay. Imagine this. If you are courting someone, okay. If my husband, when we were dating, and he never called me, never gave me any gifts, never spoke to me, I wouldn't be convinced that this man loved me at all. I'd be like, we don't never talk. I hardly ever see you. We don't communicate with one another, but you want me to believe that you love me?
Mm-hmm.
Think about how the Most High feels. We love him with our lips, but our heart is far from it.
Yeah, you want something from him. Get this here. You praying and you want something from him, right? But, or should I say, you're not praying. You want something from him, but you won't even pray. You won't even ask. Mm-hmm. You know, or you just ask once in a while, I need this. I need a job. You just walk away. Mm-hmm. And then I ain't getting no job, you know. God ain't giving me no job, you know, whatever. You better pray, right? You better get on your knees and travail for that thing.
Look at our human relationships. You know, that's
yeah.
a good example. Look at our human relationships. If you go before the Father, the way we treat each other sometimes, you know how you get those occasional calls from people?
Yeah.
The only time you hear from them is when they need something.
Yeah.
If they want you to believe that y'all friends and that you love each other, you know?
Exactly.
It's like, come on now.
Bye, Felicia.
Yeah, it's like, come on now. I'm not saying that you're supposed to talk to people all the time. You know
right.
what I mean? What I'm trying to say is when you're trying to convince someone that you love them and all you have for them is an occasional hello or you hardly ever talk to them, hardly ever see
like
no gifts.
Posts on Facebook.
But
yeah.
but you want to convince me that we're supposed to be married, we're supposed to love each other. That's how it is with the Most High. He is a jealous Elohim.
That's right.
You see, we have made everything else our gods, our Elohims, but we don't have no time for the Father. He said, if you draw nigh unto me, I'll draw nigh unto you. And so we have to keep that in mind when we go before the Father, that we have to draw nigh unto him. We can't convince him that we love him, but we hardly ever talk to him. So we got to open up that line of communication a lot better. We have to plead and understand that we need him. And he don't need us.
That's right.
You see, we are the ones who broke the fellowship with him.
That's right.
And in order to renew that, we have to prove that to him. If my people, which are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face.
Seek my face.
Repent from the things that you did that were wrong to
yep.
me. You see? And very soon, we're going to be releasing another project that we were working on. That's a very short project, but it deals with the Most High's bride. Yeah. And we hope to have that done really soon, because it's a very important message that you all need to hear. Because, again, when you want someone to believe that you love them and that you want to be married to them, you have to show that love. You have you have to seek that person. You want to be around them.
Yeah.
Yes.
That's right.
I love talking to my husband. Mm. You know, we love talking to each other. You see, we love each other's company. And even in the times when we've gotten upset at one another, you know, we don't want to be out of each other's presence. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? We just don't want to do that. And the Most High is like that. He wants us to show our love to him.
That's right.
You know what I'm saying?
That's right.
And how do you do that? You keep that line of communication open.
That's right.
You don't close it.
That's right.
And then think about this. He wakes us up. He feeds us. Who are we to try to cut him off?
Exactly.
We ain't in a position to cut him off.
That's right.
He can cut us off because we are the ones who broke that fellowship.
That's right.
You see?
You know, I got something I want to bring up real quickly here, too, because I was getting kind of late here. But I want you to get this here. I want you to really get this. This is in Daniel. Okay. I don't know if you remember, you know this story, but in Daniel chapter 10, okay, the Most High had given Daniel a vision, and Daniel had sought the Most High for understanding on his vision. Okay. Now, what happened? A hindrance came. Now, we have hindrances when we pray. And a lot of times these hindrances be an outside source. They be demonic. Demons and devils trying to hinder you in your prayers. Okay. Now, I want you to listen to this, what was said here. Okay. This is Daniel chapter 10, and this is verse 12. I'm going to look at here. Then it says, this is what the angel or the Malach said unto Daniel. Then said he unto me, fear not, Daniel, for from the first day that thou didst set thine heart to understand and to chasten thyself before Yah, thy words were heard, and I come forth, and I am for thy words. But the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me. This prince was an evil spirit that was over that particular area. I refer to it as a principality. That's another teaching I want to do one day that deals with principalities of certain areas. Okay. There are principalities that govern certain areas, wicked principalities, and they fight against Yah's holy Malach to try to hinder Yah's people. Mm-hmm. Okay. But anyway, it says here, so Daniel, when he first sought the Most High for the understanding, he went on a 21-day fast. And it took literally 21 days before Michael, the archangel, was able to fight against this spirit, this demon or principality that was trying to hinder this. Now, you hear what's going on in the spirit realm when you pray? Mm-hmm. This is why you got to prevail, okay? So it says, if you keep reading, it says, withstood me and 21 days. But lo, Michael, one of the chief princes, came and helped the other angel, you see? And I remained there with the kings of Persia. It says, now I am come to make thee understand what shall befall thy people in the latter days. So basically, you see what's going on here? You see, Daniel was praying for understanding, and there was a hindrance for 21 days. Now, what if Daniel had just said, you know, I'm not fasting, I'm not doing nothing? No, Daniel, he continued to fast and pray and seek the Most High for that understanding of that vision. Okay. Now, I said this for a reason. Okay, we know that we're going to have hindrances and everything. What this is what I want you to do. Okay, everyone out there that's listening to me, I want you to go and buy yourself some type of ledger or book or notebook of some sort. Okay, and I want you to put together a detailed prayer list for every category of your life that you can imagine. Okay, from your relationship with Yah, to your walking in him, in his spirit, to your understanding. So I want you to do a category just for spiritual things, okay? Nothing but spiritual things dealing with you and Yah. Then I want you to do a category for your relationship, like your relationship with your wife, your husband, you know, and your marriage. I want you to do a category just for that. And I want you to come up, and even if it comes to knowledge in y'all, or even with your children, I want you to do a category for that also. I want you to do a category for even if you, your job, work on your job, or if you need a job, finances, every category of your life, I want you to do a whole page or more for those categories. And I want you to write detailed prayers for each category. For instance, let's say you're having some issue with your, with one of your kids, right? And it's a particular issue, right? Mm-hmm. I want you, for your family, a prayer, a page for your family and your kids or whatever. I want you to list that thing there, right there, and say, Father, I need you to help my daughter with this, or my son is having this problem here. I want you to list all of those items, every last one of these items. And I mean, I want you to be detailed. I don't care how big it be. It could be a 10-page prayer list that you put together, but you need to do this, okay? I'll tell you why that's important. Because our minds need organization.
Yes.
Being organized in your prayer like that will make it so that you don't miss anything. Because one day you may be fervent and praying about one thing, and the next day you might not. You may forget it for 3-4 days until something else rises again. Like if I'm praying about one of my children and they have some issues, I might only pray when that issue shows up.
Mm-hmm.
But the issue never goes away, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's because I'm not persistent in my prayer. You see? So then this is what you need to do. You need to put together that list. I'm telling you, it works. Mm-hmm. My wife will tell you. I remember when we were even trying to move here, I told the Most High when I prayed, I didn't say, I found it was weird when I looked back in a prayer. I told him to guide us to the right town.
Mm-hmm.
When I say town, we're in a small town. I didn't say city. I looked back at that and I said, man, I noticed I said town. I said, he took me right to a small town.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I said, man, maybe I should have said city. Maybe I should. But I'm telling you, I prayed that prayer so hard during that time. And I told him to make a way too, so that we didn't have to get a mortgage and all of that stuff. And then all of those things was in the prayer. You get what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So you need to do this detailed prayer list, prayer list that's going to have all of those things in it. You know, and I mean, really take time. Don't think that it's going to take you 10, 15 minutes. This may take you a whole day. It may take you a couple of days to go through your life.
And it
life.
Might be a work in progress too.
That's right, because you're going to always find things that you add. And
yeah,
in
always.
That prayer list, I want you to put the date that you first prayed about it, right?
Mm-hmm.
And at the end, on the other end of where what the prayer is, I want you to put a time. I want you to say whether the prayer is answered, yes or no, and put a date there.
Mm-hmm.
And I guarantee you pray this thing, you pray like this all the time, you'll start to see the Most High start answering those prayers. And you'll start going out checking it out like, man, he did that for me. He did that for me. I'm telling you, it's going to excite your prayer like you've never seen before. You'll be praying all the time.
And go into your war room.
Yeah. Go into your war room. You don't have a room just for it. It can just be your bedroom.
Mm-hmm.
But shut the door. Mm-hmm. Send the kids out. Pray at a time that it's quiet. I will tell you, the best time is actually in the early morning.
Even if your war room is outside.
Yeah, because my wife, she goes outside. That's
go
right.
Go outside. I mean,
that's
wherever
right.
You can find some peace and
that's
quiet,
right.
Go wherever you can. I mean, even if you're in the bathroom taking a shower or whatever,
that's
wherever
right.
You can get that prayer in while you're taking a shower, letting those tears run down your
that's
eyes.
Right.
I mean, a lot of us done been there before, you know.
That's right.
Sometimes go walk out in the rain. Yes.
That's right.
You have to do that. Whatever it takes to get your prayer through to the Most High.
That's right.
That's what you must do.
That's right.
I want to go to a passage that, I'm not going to read the whole passage, Brother Joseph Reynolds posted this, chapter 9 of Revelations. Not going to read the whole chapter, but right before that in chapter, the last part of chapter 7, I just want to read this part because it just has some about tears. It says, for the Lamb which is in the midst of the throne shall feed them and shall lead them unto living fountains of water, and Yah shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. Hallelujah. We're looking forward to that day.
Yes.
But this passage that Brother Joseph Reynolds posted, he says that we're about to enter into this. We're about to enter into Revelation chapter 9. And we studied this at one time. Yes, we are. Those seals.
That's right.
Some of them have already opened.
That's
okay.
Right.
And we are right smack dab at the door of a lot of this stuff. So I'm not going to read the passage, but I do encourage everyone to read this because it says, you know, the first verse says, and the angel and the fifth angel sounded, and I saw a star fall from heaven unto the earth, and to him was given the key of the bottomless pit. And he opened the bottomless pit, and there rose a smoke out of the pit as the smoke of a great furnace, and the sun and the air were darkened by reason of the smoke of the pit. Now, a lot of people are saying that this is the CERN portal.
That's right, the CERN thing.
A lot of people are saying that,
right,
that the opening of this CERN portal may be the fulfillment of this scripture, okay? I think we should study this. I think we should understand and know what could be upon us.
Right.
Okay, we don't know the day nor the hour when all these things are going to take place, but I think as wise children of Yah, we need to pay attention to these things.
That's right.
We don't need to ignore these things because the Most High's word hath declared these things are going to happen. You got to know that some of this stuff going to have to take place sometime or another.
Yeah, it's going to take place.
And so if you don't do anything else, pray for the understanding of these things, because this war that we're in is not just a war that is just going to affect us alone. You see,
that's
the
right.
whole world is about to be affected by something.
That's
and
right.
we need to pray that we have a sure foundation that we are standing on.
Mm-hmm.
Make sure that the foundation we are standing on is sure.
That's right.
And how do we do this? We align ourselves with the word. We get in here. We find out what's going on.
That's right.
You know, a lot of times we walk about like we don't know what's going on, what's happening in the world. Things are unfolding before us daily.
That's right.
And our heads are like they're stuck down in the sand. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
We are more in tune with Hollywood than we are with holy, with holiness and righteousness.
Yeah.
You see, we need to get ourselves in alignment with what the Most High's word has said and what he has declared and what he has told us to do.
That's right.
You see?
That's right. You know, it's I tell you, it's this thing here. But when we saw the movie, The War Room, it was really a blessing. Like we said before, you got to get past all the Christian stuff, you know.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's a lot of Christian propaganda, especially at the end of the movies. A lot of Christian propaganda, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But basically, the whole moral of the movie of having a war room, that's how you go to battle, is what you need to see and what you need to get an understanding on. What they're saying, that part is truly correct. So, you know, it's awesome. I recommend you go and check it out. You know, just get past all of the Christian stuff, you know. And believe it or not, we're supposed to be that way. We're supposed to be able to watch anything and receive anything from anyone as long as it's righteous and truth. Don't matter who truth comes from, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, sometimes we make a big deal out of all these. Oh, that's a Christian pastor. I don't want to hear nothing he got to say. What if he's saying something that's truthful?
Right.
You don't want to hear it just because it comes from him?
Mm-hmm.
Huh?
The truth is the truth.
And said this, but if I could shrink down with a microphone and a microscope and put it up to a roach's mouth and it's telling me the truth, then I'm gonna listen to it.
Where do you get this stuff, man? Yeah, in all essence, imagine when Balaam the donkey spoke to him, right? What if he said, you know, you a jackass. I don't want to hear what you got to say, right? I mean, think about that, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, but instead, he listened. You know, okay, well, what you saying? What? You know, he sat there and had a conversation. He didn't look at the donkey like he was crazy.
Mm-hmm.
He had a conversation with him. You know, like, what, no big deal, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that if there's truth coming forth, regardless, you need to be able to sift. You know, like you sifting flour or wheat or something. You need to be able to pick out the bones and eat the meat, you know. You need to be able to do that and quit saying, oh, because this person came from here. This, you know, I remember one of the wisest things the person said to me came from a Jehovah's Witness years ago before I even knew Yah. Job wouldn't have said this to me, right? Mm-hmm. You know what he told me? He said, well, I'm telling you right now, if you seek the Most High with all your heart, mind, and soul, you will find him. And I said, really? And that thing set on me like, I said, wow. So if I just seek him with all my mind and heart and soul, just really seek him like that, I'm going to find him. I need to find him and tell him to sell his own advice because he didn't. You know? But I did after that. You know, I sought the Most High, and the Most High started showing me the truth. And then I ended up receiving a Ruach after that. And one thing led to another. And here I am now in more truth, you know, more understanding. So I tell you, it's amazing, you know, what Yah wants to do for us. But it's imperative that we get an understanding and know what all of this is about, what all this means. Prayer is very important. Meditation is very important. All these are like weapons. It's like war going on. And this is how we battle. This is how we fight, you know?
And yes, for Miriam mentioned about the deaths of all the animals. We've been really in tune with that kind of stuff. I mean, we look at that kind of stuff all the time around here. We choose not to dwell in La La Land.
Yeah.
There are so many articles. I mean, it's not just one. There are dozens and dozens and dozens, even hundreds of mass animal deaths that have taken place. Yes, I'm talking strange happenings. I mean, thousands of animals just dropping dead in a field.
You know, it's amazing. I think it was it this past January and February or the one before, where for almost 60 consecutive days, there was mass animal deaths. It never happened before.
Yeah.
But I had it. I actually had this documented where I'm telling you from January, almost every day in January and every day in that February of this past, earlier this year or 2014, every single day there was some mass animal death somewhere. Usually you get one a month. But this particular month, it was like crazy all over the globe. You know, so you know, there's a lot of things like this is going on, and these are, I call, wake-up calls. You know, we got to wake up. Mm-hmm. You know, we just simply got to wake up.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we're in La La Land. We're in sleep, you know, sleep zone. We and I tell you, people got to wake up.
Mm-hmm.
It's getting serious. We got to start praying right and quit. You know, I mean, what are we waiting for? Until things get worse before we finally go into a prayer room? You know?
Yeah, that's what most of us waiting on. We waiting for the bombs to start dropping and we waiting for that before we start to pray. No, it's time to do it now.
Yeah.
You know, it's good to come together and pray with your family. All of that's good. You know, sometimes we hold hands and pray. Sometimes we all go around the room. But that's not the prayer I'm talking about.
Yeah.
I'm talking about the war room. I want my children to get their own war room strategy. Whatever you got to do, make it happen. Because our relationship with the Father is individual. I tell my children, me and my husband, we tell them if mom and daddy cease to exist, that you're going to have to do this thing on your own.
That's right.
You have to have your own relationship with the Most High. It cannot be hinged on us. You see?
That's right.
We're reminded of Samuel when he was 10 years old. And the Most High kept calling his name. What's that, Samuel?
Yeah, that was Samuel, yeah.
And he kept on calling him. So he went to Eli. He said, are you calling me? He said, no, that must be the Most High calling you. And when Samuel made that excuse and said, I'm only a child. The Most High, I'm not trying to hear. I don't care how old you are or how young you
don't
are.
Don't say to me you a child. He want to hear you say it.
Y'all hear that, y'all? 13-year-olds and 16-year-olds and 19-year-olds and 10-year-olds around here. The Most High don't care about your age. If he calls you, you better hear him.
Yeah.
There is nothing that mommy and daddy can say because your relationship with the Most High is yours. It has absolutely nothing to do with us. If he calls you to say something or to do something, you must do it.
That's right.
It's very important that you listen for his voice.
Did y'all hear that?
Because he's crying out for us. I mean, no, we should be crying out to him. He's calling out to us. He's calling his children home because he says the heart of the father is going to be turned back to the children.
That's right.
His heart is going to be turned back to us. And I think we're approaching that time now to where he's turning his heart back to us. We're coming upon the end of our chastisement.
That's That's right.
And so we got to get ourselves in alignment with this outpouring of his spirit that's going to take place. Because he said, in the last days, I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. So we got to get our children ready for that. We got to prepare them. And part of that is prayer.
That's right.
And learning how to battle in prayer in our war room.
You know, that prayer list that I mentioned is actually your strategy. Mm-hmm. Think about that. That's your strategy. That's your strategy to come against all the stuff that the Satan has put in your life that's hindering you and stopping you and keeping things from you that the Most High will freely give to you.
Yes.
Satan is trying to hinder those things.
Yes.
That prayer list is your strategy. Mm-hmm. So you need to go and write out your strategy for battle.
Yes.
You hear what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. You need to go and do that. Okay.
Yes.
So did you have anything else you wanted to elaborate on or?
Nothing at all. I'm just going to gather some of these scriptures that have been posted here.
Okay.
And that's it for me.
Okay. Well, basically, we had a good time with you all today. I'm glad we were able to get two messages out. It's been wonderful.
Iris Soto says, our 19-year-old son has a beautiful spirit. We agree. We definitely agree. He does. And the rest of our children do too. They have some very beautiful spirits. Of course, as their parents, we get on them about the things that that we have to. But they do. They have some beautiful spirits.
Yeah.
Whenever we go out, one time we had they had walked ahead of us at an event that they had here in the city, and they saw me way away from them. And then someone said, "You're their mother, aren't you?" I'm like, "Who?" She said, "The two girls. You're their mother. I can tell."
It was like hundreds of people at this thing.
It was hundreds of people at this event, but this sister, she matched us up. She said, "I can just tell by their spirits and looking at you that you are their mother."
Yeah, that's
amazing.
Isn't
that sweet, Rebecca? Yes, but thank you very much for that, Iris. He is a very nice young man.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I tell you, it's just amazing. You know what the Most High has been doing in our life, and I see him doing a lot of things in a lot of people's lives. You know, and he really wants to move. You know, but prayer is like you think about it. If he say ask, and it will be given.
Mm-hmm.
So that if you don't ask, you ain't receiving.
That's right.
He says you receive not
because you ask not.
Because you ask.
Yep. Seek and you shall find. That's right.
Yeah. So you can forget it. If you ain't getting down on your knees and praying for these things or whatever, then you can forget it. So let's put together that strategy, you all. Let's put it together. Now, I'm going to ask next week. I'm going to see who put together their strategy. I'm going to ask. I'm going to tell you that now. I'm going to find out who ain't putting their strategy together. And I'm going to blast you on the video. I'm going to find out. I'm going to talk to some of y'all. I may even call you. I got a lot of y'all phone number. You know that, don't you? Okay, I'm telling you right now, y'all better put together this list. It's time to this is.
It's funny that he's saying this. I mean, I didn't want to say anything, but when I was out at the greenhouse this morning, I was sitting there and I wrote in my little journal that you gave me.
I gave her one yesterday. See, I gave her one yesterday. Yeah.
And I wrote in there. It's a number of things I wrote in there, and part of what he's saying is in that journal, and I'm going to show it to him when we're finished.
Wow.
About putting together this strategy book for these prayers, because that was one thing the old lady in the movie, she had, she didn't have a book per se, but she had a bunch of pieces of paper just posted all over the wall. That part I am giving away, okay? They were posted all over the wall. So I remember when one of the prayers came to pass for the little girl that's in the movie, and I'm giving away too much, she would have checked that off.
Yeah.
You know, so that's very important. I'm glad my husband didn't mention that, but we're going to put our children to task too.
Yeah.
For this prayer journal, that's really what it is.
Yeah.
But I'm gonna call mine the War Room Journal.
Yeah. Okay. I'm calling mine the War Book.
The War Book. We are gonna call it something, but we got to do this because I'm telling you, we all got a lot to pray for. We got people in our families that need prayer.
Yeah.
Big time prayer, and you know we love these people, so we need to pray for them, right?
That's right.
We love them, so we need to pray for them. We have people in our communities and our people at large. We need prayer. we are in the middle of a war zone and we ain't even putting together a strategy.
That's right.
So we got to come up with a strategy, people, and keep us in your prayers.
That's right.
We pray for you all. And we thank those of you who pray for us, but let's keep each other in prayer because we all need it. Part of the strategy is to pray for each other. Somebody had posted too earlier a scripture that Yah inhabits the praises of his people.
That's right.
So if you want to have him in your presence, constantly praise him.
That's right.
Okay? Praise him. If you want him in your presence, praise him.
That's right.
That's one thing we got to do.
There's a brother by the name of Darnell. Darnell, if you hear me, I'm going to give you a call. Probably not today. I'm going to try to call you tomorrow if you're if you get this message. I meant to call you a few weeks ago. We just keep getting tied up. We got so much we're trying to do with preparing for the Feast of Tabernacle. But anyway, I'm going to try to give you a call within a day or so. If I don't, if you get a chance, you just give me a call. Not today, though. I'm going to be a little busy today. Mm-hmm. Not doing work, though. But doing some things that the Most High want me to do, you know. But anyway, we love you all so much, and we can't say it enough. You all family.
Yes, we love our family very much.
We love our family.
You all very dearly.
Yeah.
And
we know you're praying for us, and we're praying for you all, too.
That.
Yeah, we appreciate it. Yes, indeed. We thank the Most High for you, you know.
Yeah, we're gonna all talk about this. We got to keep this thing going. This movie just came out. We got to keep this thing going as far as this prayer. We have to because we need it. We all need it very, very deeply because our enemy is busy. And there are so many passages that we need to read. I'm going to copy this chat so that I can keep hold of some of these scriptures that were posted, those that we didn't get to.
Okay, good, good. Okay. Yeah. When I know time is getting behind us, I need to get me something for the belly. You know, the only thing I had this morning was water and a pear. Mm-hmm. You know, so... But anyway, we love you. We want you to continue to seek his word. And don't forget that prayer list, okay? Put together that prayer list, okay? So on that note, we're going to say
Shalom, family. We love you.